You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
From the depths of the sea, this is Transmissions from Atlantis, a sci-fi, fantasy, and horror podcast with a special emphasis on Doctor Who. Featuring the creators of Seekers of the Lost Worlds, Rita and J.C. Delatorre.
Hey there, everybody. Welcome to episode 140 of Transmissions from Atlantis. My name is J.C. Delatorre.
And I'm Rita Delatorre.
And we have a jam-packed show for you this week.
Well, what we got is, on our rapid-fire segment, we'll talk about Sony Television and its film assets may go up for sale. Also, the Infinity Wars trailer, Solo, a Star Wars story trailer. There's new Star Wars films coming from Game of Thrones creators. Also, Supernatural's Wayward Sisters, Backdoor Pilot, the new horror flick Winchester, the Cloverfield Paradox, the new Deadpool 2 trailer, Black Panther's Rotten Tomatoes craziness, and Elon Musk sends a Tesla into space.
That was
a mouthful.
Take a breath, man. Our main topic this week is the new Netflix series Altered Carbon. And in our Doctor Who segment, is Doctor Who moving to Sundays? And Georgia Tennant is annoyed that Jenny won't be brought back. But let's go ahead and get started with Rapid Fire!
Rapid Fire?
Fire!
Fire!
Okay, let's go with Rapid Fire. Sony Television and its film assets may go for sale.
I don't know what to think about that. I mean, so I guess that means Disney can buy Spider-Man.
Yes, so it's all part of Disney's plan to rule the world. This is their next step.
Mickey Mouse is going to be a dictator.
Yes. So is there going to be any company that's not going to be Disney? It's almost like in Demolition Man where you have Taco Bell, where every restaurant is Taco Bell.
That is true. The Infinity Wars trailer.
All right. So we got to see the Infinity Wars trailer during the Super Bowl. Oh my God.
Well, let's see. I mean, all I can really say about the trailer is everybody is in it.
Yes. If you have a tight superhero suit, you're probably in it too.
Yeah. Sorry, DC. You're not in it.
Well, except for DC, yeah, because none of DC's people are going to be in it. But I was impressed that they were able to get that many people into one single trailer. It's going to be
epic.
Epic, yeah. It's going to be interesting. I don't know how it's all going to work together because so many of the Avengers movies worked because everybody had their little bits.
True, but we'll have to see because the Avenger movies have been pretty good so far.
Yep.
All right, Solo, a Star Wars story. The trailer. During Super Bowl.
Yes, also during Super Bowl, and they released another trailer right after that. And I gotta say, I'm more optimistic.
The only complaint, though, is you don't really see Solo speaking a lot.
I think there's a reason for that because apparently the kid can't act. So I think
again, he was coached by Harrison Ford himself.
Yeah, so I think they limited his, speaking part so, people still want to see the movie.
Well, we'll see. Either way, we're going to see the film.
Yes.
It's Star Wars.
It's Star Wars. Although there are reports that Disney is kind of giving it the Lone Ranger treatment, so they may not actually,
Which is a shame because the Lone Ranger was awesome.
Yep.
All right, speaking of Star Wars, there's new Star Wars films coming from the creators of Game of Thrones in addition to the new Rian Johnson trilogy.
Yeah, so how about that? A new trilogy in addition to the Rian Johnson trilogy, but by the Game of Thrones folks. What could that possibly be?
Considering what the Game of Thrones folks have been giving us, you know, the last few years, I'm pretty optimistic that what they're going to give us. All we have to say is please stay true to the original material.
Now, I would assume that there's not going to be all kinds of nudity and, you know...
Well, you expect that of Game of Thrones, but not Star Wars.
Yeah. It's not going to be part of the Skywalker saga, so that'll be interesting. All right, Supernatural's Wayward Sisters backdoor pilot finally aired.
I have to say, I was very impressed with the pilot. Mm-hmm. It's nowhere near what that other potential pilot was, the one with the vampires.
Oh, the one that was absolutely terribly awful. And yeah, that nobody was wanted horrible. To see that.
Yes. But Wayward Sisters, yes, that needs to be a series.
Yes. And it's definitely going to be a series. At least we hope that's going to be. It looked like it did pretty good well in the ratings. And it was one of the top scripted shows of that night. So I think there's a good opportunity for that show to actually go to series.
Yep, I agree. I think it's going to be awesome. And that's a spinoff I'd really want to see.
Yes, absolutely.
All right, so speaking of the Winchesters, did you get to go see the Winchester Mystery House movie? Because it was awesome.
It was fantastic. See, you know, a lot of people love the, you know, slasher, gore, blood everywhere kind of movies.
I don't
like that. But I love a good, scary ghost movie that doesn't need a lot of gore to freak you out.
Exactly, like The Others or The Haunting.
Yep.
13 Ghosts had a bit of gore in it, but it was still more of the ghost scares than it really was about the gore.
Yep.
And Winchester House encompasses all of these films. It's all about the scare. There's no gore in it. There's just, you know, the spirits and the history about the house, and they pulled it off so well.
Helen Mirren was fantastic. I gave it a 10.
No, me too. I gave it a 10, and it's going to be an instant Blu-ray buy for us.
Yep, so unknown to everyone, Netflix dropped the next Cloverfield movie, The Cloverfield Paradox.
And this is what's so funny. Watching Super Bowl, here's the commercial for it. And as soon as the commercial was done,
it was available on Netflix.
Now, like, go see it now. Like, now.
Yeah. So it's like, what?
Yeah. And nobody even knew this film was coming. At least I didn't.
No, I knew that they filmed a new Cloverfield movie. I just didn't know it was going to drop Super Bowl Sunday.
Like right there.
Yeah.
Like, hi, here's our new film. Watch it now.
Yes. So real quick, what did you think of it?
I thought it was okay. The first film was a found footage, and it was really about the monsters and all of that, but the second film was really more about parallel universes and not as much about the monsters.
Well, you're forgetting 10 Cloverfield Lane. That was the second movie. This is actually the third movie.
Yeah, well, 10 Cloverfield Lane, I think, even had less to do with the original film.
All right, so Deadpool 2 trailer dropped with Cable in it. So what did we think?
Looks awesome. I mean, trailer looks as amazing as the original one did. I can't wait for the Deadpool movie.
Yep, we got our first look at Cable. And, of course, Deadpool doing Deadpool things, so, you know, it's Deadpool being Deadpool.
Yeah, so just a reminder, people, this is going to be a rated R movie just like the first one was, so don't take your kids and then complain.
This is not kid-friendly. There's going to be cuss words, there's going to be nudity, there's going to be obscene jokes.
Violence.
Lots and lots of violence.
So, you've been warned.
Yes. And it's going to be glorious!
Yep. Alright, so there is an actual conspiracy among DC fans to sandbag the ratings of Black Panther. Is this racially motivated, or is this just DC fans being jealous?
Nope, I don't think it's racially motivated. I think it's stupidity motivated. Because there is this thought that Marvel fans actually sandbag the ratings of Justice League instead of Justice League, you know, just sucking.
So these are comic book fans being stupid.
Yes. So they believe that in retaliation for Marvel fans, quote-unquote, sandbagging the Justice League ratings, that they're going to do the same to Black Panther.
And the funny thing is, you know, this is what also happened to the Star Wars Last Jedi film.
Yep. So here's a funny thing. So far, the Rotten Tomatoes ratings for Black Panther, 100% fresh.
Yeah. I can't wait for this film.
It's going to be awesome! All right, so one of the coolest stunts ever was done by Elon Musk and SpaceX, using their new huge rocket to shoot a Tesla Roadster into space and then film the results. So did you see the spaceman?
Yes, I saw the spaceman.
That was probably one of the coolest things I think I've ever seen.
Yeah, you want to know what my thought on it was, other than the fact that it was cool?
What?
I'm like, what a waste of a Tesla Roadster. You could have just given it to me. I would have taken it.
So I saw a really funny meme today, and it was a meme with Elon Musk and says, when you put a dead hooker in the back of your roadster and then shoot it into space, and everybody applauds.
Either way, it's still cool. It's, of course, going to overshoot Mars, and it's going to head to the asteroid belt, which means it's going to knock an asteroid, you know, out of alignment, and then whoop, there goes Earth.
Yeah, so wouldn't that be ironic?
Don't you think?
Yes. All right, so that does it for Rapid Fire. Stay tuned as next we delve into the wild, hard sci-fi world of Netflix Altered Carbon. Ooh.
What are we doing?
I don't know. I mean, are we really adventurers? I'm not exactly Harrison Ford.
I think we should do it.
I have learned about you from a mutual acquaintance and have ascertained that your adventurer spirit can continue where I left off. Enclosed in the suitcase is all you need to begin your journey, your servant. This looks really old.
Well, what you have here, Rita, is a stone tablet with ancient Sumerian inscription. This word right here, if I didn't know better, it was Atlantis.
Atlantis? As in the lost continent? I mean, that's just fiction.
Do you happen to be an archaeologist?
That depends.
On what?
On if Indiana Jeb here's got something else to wear.
Hey.
I mean, come on, really?
The reason we're here is because the tablet said we would find the key to Solon in the Cave of the Protected.
Cave of the Protected?
Yeah, it's somewhere here on Kauai, in the deepest part of the jungle, in fact.
The private journal of Captain Barnaby H. McIntosh, privateer and adventurer.
This journal reads like a fantasy novel.
So what have you found so far?
It's hard to read, but McIntosh is talking about someone trying to gain access to Atlantis.
Clarius?
The portal to Atlantis was sealed to protect it from Clarius.
But why? I mean, who is this guy?
Another trap.
What is it?
Spores. Toxic spores. Hit the ground. We gotta go. Move, move.
It's a cryptex like Da Vinci Code.
Oh my.
Is that real? Hey, shouldn't we be in like a map room or something?
There's a red mark. Is that pointing to the Bahamas?
Alright, let's just get into some dry clothes.
Hey, did you bring a hairdryer or a fan?
I think Sarah has one.
Does she? Do you have one?
Yeah, like... No, I
we're
don't.
We're here prepared.
You're an adventurer ever.
You got your flat on you.
Alright, so next up, we're going to talk about the new Netflix hard sci-fi series called Altered Carbon. Alright, so let's give people a little bit of background on Altered Carbon. In Altered Carbon, every human being at the age of 1 year, 1 years of age, mm-hmm. gets what's called a stack. A stack is like this small, I would say, disc that goes in the back of the neck.
Yep.
And what they do is the person's consciousness gets downloaded into this stack.
Right.
And your body just becomes a sleeve. So if your body dies, you just get a new sleeve and you just keep doing this indefinitely.
Yep.
Which means there's immortality now.
Yes. So it's an interesting concept. It's a bit like Blade Runner, I'd say, you know, where you have synthetic humans and whatnot. But it's a lot different in the fact that they're using these humans as kind of like carriers, you know. And they're not all synthetic either. Some of them are just used bodies that somebody else had vacated that,
yeah,
you know, somebody else jumped into.
Used to sleeves, sleeves that can be cloned, sleeves that are synthetic. And the whole premise of the story is this guy was, I guess, in cold storage because it was a form of prison for about 250 years.
Right.
He gets brought out, and technically he's owned by another guy, or leased, as they were calling it on the show, because this guy wants to solve his own murder.
Right.
Even though the guy technically isn't dead. And why? Because this guy is rich enough that his consciousness gets backed up into a satellite, so even if his stack gets destroyed, boom, he gets downloaded into a new stack and a new sleeve.
Right, but the catch was that there's a time period, right? So
yeah,
what was it, like
48 hours.
48 hours, right? Was it hours or minutes?
It was 48 hours.
48 hours, okay. So in that 48 hours, if they catch you just at the right time, you will basically forget those last 2 days.
Exactly. And that's what happened to this guy.
Yeah.
So he's rich enough that he can pretty much get away with just about everything.
Yep.
Now, the whole thing about this is that there is what's called stack death. Even though, yes, you can be immortal, you can move from one sleeve to another and never age and just continue living your existence. But if your stack gets destroyed and blown away, and you're not one of those rich people that can get, you know, updated and backed up every 48 hours,
you're dead.
You're dead, dead.
Yeah.
So here is the crux of it. Human souls, should they or should they not be downloaded into essentially a technological device?
And so that is really the question, the significance of the soul in Altered Carbon. Would you want to have your consciousness put in a new body or just go away into the ether once your life was done?
Well, here's the thing. Is the soul actually even being downloaded into the stack? I think a person's consciousness in their mind is separate from the soul.
Is it, though? Because everything that you are is what your brain and your consciousness, your soul, comes together as. So if all of that is put in a microchip, then technically everything that you are is in that microchip.
Yeah, but that's everything that you are electronically and digitally. But is that really considered a soul?
Yes, because that's all of you. That's basically who you are.
I don't necessarily agree with that. And that's part of the controversy with the series. There are characters in the series that don't believe in, you know, jumping from one sleeve to another.
They still believe in God, and they believe in heaven, and they believe in hell, and they think that by using this technology that you are pretty much guaranteeing a one-way ticket to hell.
And here's the thing. Everybody has to use this technology. You know, at 1 year of age, you're
going
to get the stack no matter what your religion is, no matter what your gender is, you're getting it.
Right.
But what a lot of people in the show believe is the sleeve you were born with should be the sleeve that you die with, and you should not be re-sleeved after that.
Right.
But part of the problem is, and something that you see in this show, with time, and especially with people who have a lot of money, their lives become very stale.
They get bored. Well, imagine being immortal, you know, except everybody around you is also immortal, so it's not like, you know, anything interesting happens.
Yeah.
I mean, these people that are the elites, you know, what did they call them? The meths, yeah. You know, they are the elites. They live in the clouds, literally live in the clouds, you know, so that they don't have to associate with those on the ground. And their lives are just parties and business deals and just making more and more money. And it if that's your life for 200, 300, 400 years.
Or in the case of Bancroft, 1,000.
That's got to get boring, right?
Yeah.
You know, if that's all there is to life, you know, where's the entertainment? So, obviously, they have to try to find new ways to entertain themselves, and some of these ways are pretty deviant.
Yeah, and that's where the more sexual aspects of the show come in.
Right.
And it's not just having sex with a random person. It's going above and beyond that, like killing another sleeve while having carnal relations, for example.
Right.
And their pleasures and their tastes get more and more demanding or sick.
And dark.
Yeah. And dark.
And dark. And
the older they get.
And basically what happens is, you know, if they happen to kill that person and they pay for that person to get a new body, a new sleeve. So it's... It can get a little kind of creepy. And, of course, there's also the VR factor as well, because there is this VR element as well that where you can actually go put somebody into VR and torture them. I mean, like...
Endlessly
torture them.
Torture them, bring them back to life, torture them again, bring them back to life, and it's endless and just continuous.
And to the point where, you know, they can... You can burn somebody alive and then reboot them. And then do it all over again.
But here's the thing. You can still drive people insane.
Yes.
And that happens to one of the characters in the show.
Yep.
The rich people in this show kind of remind me of that one kid who's been off and on in the news for the past couple years. The rich kid who raped a girl, but felt like he's rich and he can get away with anything. I'm sure you know, remember about the kid I'm talking about.
I'm sure. And
the fact that...
Let's say there's plenty of examples of it.
And I'm not even just talking about him from that.
And basically that's the way it is with these meths in the show. They think that the grounders are so...
Beneath them
that they don't matter at all. They are nothing. So they can do with as they please, so to speak.
And even though, if you think about it, the grounders are also immortal, folks.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just a mess that are immortal.
Right.
Everybody is. Now, mind you, grounders have a much more difficult time finding a new sleeve if they lose the one they had.
Which is why a lot of them will use used sleeves. You know, for example, our character is actually an Asian male, but he gets sleeved into a Caucasian.
Yes. And in the beginning of the show, we see a 7-year-old girl who gets re-sleeved into the body of a tall, older woman because that's all that was available.
Like a grandma.
Yeah, like a grandmother. And it feels wrong. The whole premise of that system just seems wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you're super rich, you're just
going to... You get the scraps.
Yeah, you just get the scraps.
You get whatever's available. Yeah. So
would you want to live forever if that's what your choices were?
I wouldn't want to live on the ground, let me tell you that.
No. But I don't necessarily want to live up in the clouds with the self-entitled douchebags either.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so then that leaves us right back to the original question. Should a soul be sent to a new stack or be allowed to go to heaven?
Well, I think that the idea of stacks is an abomination.
Really?
Because there is heaven and hell. Well, I don't know necessarily about hell, but there have been so many instances of near-death experiences that there is a strong belief in heaven. Well, guess what? You create stacks. You download people's souls into these stacks. They continue to live, you know, eon after eon. No one's ever going to go to heaven. You're never going to die. Your soul is going to stagnate and rot inside a stack instead of finding enlightenment and ascending into heaven to be with God.
That's true. But then again, you know, if you're somebody that doesn't believe in God, if you are an atheist, for example, and you have the opportunity to have eternal life,
Especially if, like, let's say you're a scientific genius.
Yeah, like if you're a scientific genius and you basically have the ability to be able to continue to do your work, to be able to do your studies,
okay,
to learn.
Let's say there's an exception.
But if it's one person gets this, then there's going to be other people that be like, well, what about me? Why can't I have what this scientist
has? Yeah, but
what
if it's a compromise? What if, like, let's say we have this one scientific genius who is literally on the edge of finding the cure for cancer, mm-hmm. right? And if he dies, his research is going to die with him. Well, what if instead of re-sleeving
but that's
him,
basic,
let me finish.
No, but that's basically what happened was this one person, in trying to find some kind of way to extend their ability to research, created the sleeve. And sure enough, it got bastardized by the rich and taken, you know, and then before you knew it, everybody was being sleeved.
Well, then don't stack anybody. No, nobody should be stacked.
And then here's the other question. You know, they spin up murder victims so that the murder victims can say, hey, that dude murdered me. If you don't have that ability, then you just have to do it kind of the old-fashioned way, right?
Well, my theory with that is...
there's no justice.
If you're going to create the stacks in a person's original sleeve... okay, we know that once that sleeve dies, they can take that stack and put it in what they called cold storage. Mm-hmm. So the person isn't active, they're sleeping, mm-hmm. right? Now, what if they didn't do that at all? What if the stacks and the sleeves were both destroyed at the time of sleeve death? But in the case of murder victims, you put the sleeve in cold storage and that person can be questioned, not in a sleeve, but in VR until the case is closed.
Well, if the stack is destroyed, it doesn't matter.
Well, if the stack is destroyed, that doesn't matter. But if the stack isn't destroyed, that stack is a witness.
Right. But it
can be considered evidence.
It makes you wonder, though, why would there ever be murder or anything like that anyway? If people know that unless you kill the stack, that person's going to come back and just finger you.
Well, that's a problem because... there was a lot of murder during this show. There was mm-hmm. a lot of people killing other people. And the reason for it is because there is no more fear that if you kill somebody, that person's going to stay dead.
Right.
Do you remember that Bruce Willis movie where everybody had their own robotic avatars and nobody left their homes? People would kill people. People would commit suicide because they knew... that they would just wake up in their homes and nothing ever happened. Mm-hmm. Except, you know, the destruction of the robotic avatar. This is the exact same thing.
Yep.
One dude is going to kill the other person because what are going to be the repercussions? So the other person might have to get another sleeve. Okay, so there'll be a lawsuit for financial setbacks.
No, there is punishment. So they get de-sleeved and they get put into cold storage for 200 something years to think about what they did.
to think about what they did. But there is no real repercussions unless you deal with stack death.
Yeah. All right. So we talked a lot about the overall concept of the show. What did you think of the show?
I loved it.
Yeah.
It not only did it remind me of Blade Runner, it kind of had a Eon Flux, Ghost in a Shell. Vibes to it.
I'd say more Ghost in a Shell than Ian.
Yeah, more Ghost in a Shell.
Yeah.
But it's such hard sci-fi, and we rarely get that these days. Mm-hmm. The Expanse, for example, was considered hard sci-fi.
Right.
And
but this show was a million times better than The Expanse because it moved at a good clip. The writing was very good. And I also thought that the main characters really brought life to those characters. You felt like... like the main character, the guy that's investigating everything, you felt his inner anguish of, you know, having to face the person that he actually has to face at the end, you know, and have to deal with all of the turmoil that comes with that.
It's not just that. It's being put in a sleeve you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
It's being put into a sleeve that knows other people.
Yeah.
And, you know, that creates issues.
Yeah, and that person's... sins come to you because you have their face, so everybody thinks you're that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, needless to say, the show was absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
And I will recommend it to anybody. Now, if you don't like a lot of swearing and nudity, then you might want to skip it, because there is a lot of that.
Yeah. If you're used to Game of Thrones, it's no worse than Game of Thrones. So, there's a lot of violence, a lot of sex, a lot of nudity. There are definitely plenty of language issues going on, so it's not for kids, but it's definitely a show that was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. I loved the whole mystery of it. You know, who killed Bancroft? That whole deal, all the way to the end, I gotta admit, I did not expect the ending that came.
Yeah, the ending was much better than I could have imagined. I really expected a lot worse, mm-hmm. and thankfully it went nowhere near where I was thinking it was.
And the great thing about it is I really enjoy mysteries that I can't just immediately figure out. I mean, there are some aspects to it that I pretty much figured out pretty quickly, like certain people that were supposed to be dead weren't dead, that kind of thing. I kind of figured that out pretty quick. But with that said, I did really, really enjoy the build-up, and I didn't see the twist ending. I really didn't.
So, no, I didn't either. But it was so good. Yeah, so. It really was amazing.
And I loved the whole Raven concept, too, of the virtual hotel.
Yes.
With the AI interface. That's the hotel.
Poe was one of my favorite characters.
Poe was one of my favorite characters. Yeah, definitely. So, so what would you rate Altered Carbon?
Oh, I'm giving it an 11. It was good, man. Yeah. It was good watchings.
Yep. I will definitely give it a 10. It was an excellent show. We highly recommend it. It's something that you should definitely check out. All right. Coming up next, we're going to talk Doctor Who.
Who?
Who?
ESO. 7 years of keeping it really geeky.
What are you trying to do? You ruined my record, man. I just bought it.
Hey, you guys!
How exciting. Spoilers.
Come! It's 106 miles to Chicago. We got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses. Hit it.
Have fun storming the castle.
Think it'll work?
It would take a miracle.
Bye-bye.
The Earth Station 1 podcast. It's time to let your inner geek out to play. You can find them at www.earthstation1.com or up on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, or wherever fine podcasts are found. Peace, and we're done.
Hello, this is Nick Briggs, the voice of the Daleks, and you're listening to Transmissions from Atlantis. And I urge you to listen, or you will be exterminated!
All right, folks, it's time to talk Doctor Who.
Yay!
Yay!
Even though we're getting into that time of year where Doctor Who news is kind of hard to come by.
Yeah, it's a little light in the Doctor Who news department, but there was a major rumor that came out, and you got to take this with a grain of salt, folks, because this is the London Express, you know, daily news kind of tabloid nonsense. But the rumor is that BBC is moving Doctor Who to Sundays. What do you think?
I think they can move it to pretty much any day of the week, and I'd still watch it, so.
Of course.
To me, it's really not that big of a deal.
So, apparently, with Strictly Come Dancing kind of screwing up all of the Saturday lineup for the BBC, and everything kind of has to morph around Strictly Come Dancing, it got to the point where they decided they feel that it's hurt Doctor Who's ratings, and the reason why Doctor Who's ratings has not been what it used to be when it was in its prime. So they're hoping that with the change to the female doctor, with the new showrunner, and maybe with a day change from Saturday to Sunday, where it can go back to tea time in London, where it's the perfect hour for people to be able to watch it, they believe that that's where things can get better for them.
Well, I mean, suits me just fine. The only problem is we're going to have a conflict once football season starts.
Yeah, and the bad part is apparently this new season is starting when? September.
Yeah, guess what starts then? Football.
So, yes. I will be having some issues with that because I'll have my desire to watch football games. You won't have a problem because you don't care about football, but I definitely will have a problem with that. So Sundays would be terrible for me, especially in the fall, but overall, if it's better for Doctor Who, then I believe that, you know, they got to do what they got to do. If it keeps Doctor Who on the air, if it strengthens the show, Saturday, Sunday, Tuesday, does it really matter? It's Doctor Who, right?
Right. So as it turns out, Georgia Tennant, formerly Georgia Moffat, ticked off that Jenny was never brought back to the show.
Yeah. So. So we know that Jenny's coming back in the Big Finish audios, and everybody's excited about that. But apparently, Georgia was a little ticked off when Stephen Moffat and Russell T. Davies had a little conversation about Jenny. And apparently, at some kind of convention or something, they had made a joke that Jenny, right after she had left the Doctor, flew into a moon or something, and her character's dead.
Yeah, and that didn't sit very well with Georgia.
Right, so... she wasn't too happy. She just pretty much gave them a WTF. What's going on with that? And apparently there has been some bad blood ever since. But Georgia did say that she hopes that with the new showrunner and the new doctor, that she'll have the opportunity to rejoin the actual TV version of Doctor Who and not just Big Finish.
Oh, man. Can you imagine? And there's even rumors that Rose might be coming back.
Yeah. I don't think
so. So can you imagine the new female doctor, Jenny and Rose in the TARDIS with River?
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit about that. Rose coming back again. Do we really want to see it?
No.
I'm with you.
No.
Rose had her time. She was a great companion. You know, she was great with the Ninth Doctor. She was okay with the Tenth Doctor until they got the whole weepy love story thing, and then that's when it kind of all went to hell with Rose. But
I mean, mind you, all of this is based on an Instagram photo that she posted that had a whole bunch of happy faces and an emoji of a rose at the end of
it.
I'm like, so from that, people, fans are taking that Rose is coming back. It's just an emoji, people.
Yes.
She just said she was making an announcement, and there was a rose emoji that could literally mean nothing.
Yep. And from what I understand, I believe they announced recently that she's coming to New York to do some kind of like speaking tour or something about acting or whatever. So that may be her big announcement. But we don't know. You know, who knows? Maybe she will return to Doctor Who. But for me, if I'm wanting a character to come back to Doctor Who, I would love to see what Jack Harkness makes of a female doctor.
Oh, you know him.
Yes.
He'll pretty much do anything.
Yeah. But how would that dynamic work with the female doctor and Jack? You know, because the male doctor didn't have any time for Jack. Would the female doctor be any different?
I don't know.
It'd be interesting.
It would be interesting. And, I mean, I even hope River makes a comeback.
It would be very interesting to see River interacting with a female doctor, because we know that River's had wives. So she doesn't have a problem with that. But, yeah, it would be kind of interesting. My ultimate episode would be the female doctor, Jodie's doctor, Jack, and River in one episode.
Oh, man, that the craziness that would ensue.
Yep.
I don't know if the world is ready for that.
Well, throw in Amy Pond and I wouldn't be ready for it, let me tell you.
Well, that does it for Doctor Who. Like we said, the news, you know, for right now is a bit light.
Yep, and that's going to do it for this episode of Transmissions from Atlantis. For the next episode, we are obviously going to be talking Black Panther.
Because it looks epic.
Yep, it looked epic. We'll also preview the return of Jessica Jones and a whole bunch of other cool stuff. Right?
Right.
But until then, allons-y.
Allons-y.
Goodbye, everybody.
Look sharp, Rose Tyler, allons-y. And then, it'd be really brilliant if I met someone called Alonzo, because then I could say allons-y, Alonzo, every time.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network, your station for all things geek, classic, current, and beyond. Be part of the crew at esonetwork.com.